With that, I would turn to Dennis Pierce, President of Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen. You're recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning. Thank you, Chairman DeFazio, Ranking Member Crawford, and members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to appear before you this morning. My name is Dennis Pierce. I am president of the oldest trade union in North America, the Brotherhood of Locomotive Engineers and Trainmen. I am also president of the Teamsters Rail Conference, of which BLET is the founding member. My comments today will focus primarily on the Class 1 freight railroads, but before I get into that, I think we should recognize that our members also carry millions of passengers on Amtrak, commuter, and intercity passenger railroads. We should not forget that commuter rail carries 500 million passenger trips a year in the most congested portions of the shared national rail network. I'd like to start by telling you about the members of the BLET. We're in the front row. We're watching why shippers can't get their shipments. But our members are proud and hardworking Americans. They work long, hard careers, moving freight, America's freight safely and efficiently. They are the ultimate essential employee. But there's numerous problems that are forcing our members to reconsider their career choices right now. The way they're being treated on a day in and day out basis, and the way the railroads are being mismanaged, in our opinion, is breeding misery and contempt for Class 1 railroads. The root of these changes, as has already been discussed, generally come from the business model known as precision scheduled railroading, which is neither precise, it's not scheduled, and it's not railroading. Here's just one reason why. The vast majority of our members do not work scheduled jobs. That is a big misconception. They work on call at randomly chosen times dictated by rail management. In many cases, they get little, if any, advance notice of when that call will come. In recent years, they've been subjected to harsher and harsher attendance policies that demand they work day in and day out. These policies subject our members to disciplinary consequences, including termination, even if they take time off because they're too tired or too sick to work safely. These policies are destroying the lives of our members, even to the point of destroying their families. These policies are part of a fewer employees doing more business model that is understaffing the railroads and destroying the supply chain with no regard to the impact on shippers. In sum, today's Class 1's operating model is requiring our members to work longer trains, longer hours, longer round trips with less time at home than they receive in their away from home terminals in hotels in many cases. And if personal issues come up that require them to be at home more than their legal rest, they stand to be disciplined just to tend to their family matters. The workforce is stretched too far, and there is no elasticity to handle even the slightest unplanned event on the railroad, and those things happen daily. The point here is that poor safety and operating practices and burnt out workers only lead to poor and inefficient customer service. This is where the STB can come in. We know the STB is here to ensure that service from the railroads meets the needs of the customers. But PSR has thrown the needs of the customers as well as the needs of the employees out the window. In practical terms, PSR and PSR-like strategies have led to furloughs, and most importantly, longer, slower trains, clogged ports, and a workforce stretched to work beyond the point of safe operations. The current business model is to furlough employees and just make everyone that's left do more. This business model is delaying shipments, leaving store shelves half empty. We've all seen it. But STB can play a role in changing these business practices. BLET believes that STB playing a more active role in regulating railroads can help by handling service complaints in a timelier and more effective manner. Addressing why shipments don't show up on time, which our members see daily, and the related impact on the nation's supply chain is critical to the U.S. economy. One role for Congress would also be to better define the common carrier obligation so that the existing requirements can be effectively enforced by the Surface Transportation Board. This could also come with an attendant clarification that Congress affirms that STB is both capable and responsible for enforcement of the railroad's common carrier obligations. BLET appreciates the opportunity to testify here today. My written comments get into much more detail, including our opposition to so-called reciprocal switching. Congress and STB should take an interest in what PSR is doing to shippers, and because of the impact and the core impact to the shippers, what it's doing to the employees of these railroads. And this is where Congress can help give STB the legislative tools to ensure that America's freight railroads provide a world-class service. Thank you, and I look forward to any questions you might have.
Thank the gentleman for his statement. We now turn to
Mr. Pierce and Mr. John. I have serious concerns about the effect of precision scheduled railroading, not only for the impacted workers, but also for the shippers that have that have to move their cargo. Running longer trains raises the possibility of safety concerns and could decrease the role of the rail in the nation's supply chain. Can you both explain how PSR has affected your work in the rail sector, and how do you think Congress should act in response? Mr. Pierce, let's begin with you.
Thank you, Chairman Payne. I think it's really simple to explain. Twice the train length, twice the amount of time to build that train, twice the amount of time to put that train away. If there is an unplanned emergency, twice the amount of time to walk that train. We're running trains in excess of 2 to 3 miles on any given day. And members, if they are forced to walk that train or out there literally for hours on end, just walking to the rear of the train and walking back. Radio communications don't work that well that far. It has become a safety issue. At the same time, the railroad is literally shutting itself down by running trains do not fit their physical plant. We park shorter trains to run longer trains, and then we cruise because the trains that have the other crews that are parked don't have enough time to get to their terminal. All of this impacts the shipping. All of it prevents the cars from getting to where they need to go. It's as though the railroads don't really care if those cars ever get there, is our viewpoint. And I just one last thing. There is no suggestion box for the employees to tell the railroad what they think they could do better. It doesn't exist. I appreciate the opportunity to bring those issues here. We see it every day, what could be done more efficiently that is not happening right now.
Thank you. Now I have the gentlelady from Nevada, Ms. Titus, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me say thank you to the railroad industry for your help in trying to get the supply chain problems in line. And you've been on the front lines yourselves throughout this pandemic, and we appreciate that. And you have done it while causing much less pollution than some of our trucking friends. So thank you to the railroads for that. And then, Mr. Pierce, as we push for more profit for the railroads from Wall Street, how have these mergers affected our railroad workers? And what can we do as we look to revise or reestablish or reauthorize this agency to protect those workers?
Thank you. I think if you look back at the history of the big merger push of the late 90s, there were multiple meltdowns. A lot of missteps in trying to integrate workforces, integrate what were once competing railroads into a single unit. With the two primary ones on the landscape coming forward with the CPKCS and the CSX acquisition of Pan Am, we've been very involved with the STB about trying to make sure that the protective conditions that the STB has the right to impose are included in any decisions to make sure that the workers get a fair shake when it comes to how these railroads are merged into a single entity.
Well, I'm glad to hear that, because it's not all just about profit, it's about safety as well.
We know that the rail industry is one of the most efficient parts of our supply chain. However, we also know that government regulation and overreach has made this job harder. Whether this falls within the STB reauthorization or not, and this question is for anyone, what could we do tomorrow to alleviate some of your biggest government-related stressors that make your jobs more difficult?
Mr. Congressman, if I'm...
Yeah, go ahead.
One of the challenges, we talk a lot about staffing, and even while Mr. Jeffries may be right that certain railroads are having trouble finding employees, certain railroads still have people furloughed while they're forcing others to work more. Adding insult to injury, while you're offering incentives to hire, the nation's Class 1 railroad employees have been 2 years without a contract. They worked through a pandemic. The railroads are reporting record profits. And it's an insult to everyone that you're going to pay new employees more than the ones that got you through the crisis without a contract. So there's all sorts of things that could be done to alleviate the staffing problems.
Thank you. Next, we'll hear from Mr. Lynch for 5 minutes of questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really appreciate it. I, for one, am very grateful to our rail workers, especially this last 2 years has been very, very difficult. They've been on the front lines and they have performed magnificently on behalf of the American people in doing that what they can to alleviate the supply chain problems that we've had. President Pierce, you've been, look, I've negotiated plenty of collective bargaining agreements during my career as an iron worker and also as a labor attorney. Can you talk to us about the fact that we've lost so many skilled employees? Some of them are still furloughed, yet we have another effort of bringing new people into the industry. Can you talk a little bit about the perspective of our regular rail workers and what they're dealing with on a daily basis?
Thank you, Congressman. I think it's a very critical part of what's wrong with the supply chain and what's wrong with staffing. As I said, our membership has been, and this is all rail unions, this isn't just mine, they've all been without a contract for over 2 years while the records made record profits. Every profit report that came out this spring has been best ever. And the employees see that. And new people that want to go to work in a good industry see that. The continuing attack on the second person on the train, how do you hire conductors when you're telling them you want to get rid of them? That's counterproductive. Add to this that these policies that the railroads have adopting as part of PSR, forcing workers to work more, taking away their family life, at the expense of laying someone else off. And it's absurd to me that there's any doubt as to why people are not interested in hiring out at the railroads right now. They're having a hard time even at job fairs. 10 people take the job, only 5 show up when they find out what it looks like. And that's my job, that's our job as unions to try to improve on that, but we need a willing partner across the table. And for 2 years, we've sat across the table with no willing partners to try to address these concerns.
From a safety standpoint, President Pierce, how important is it to have that second employee on that train, especially given the length of some of these trains?
I think it's critical. I think the second set of eyes and ears, the ability to, address issues that happen on the fly, grade crossing accidents, derailments, these are things where the ground crew goes back in short order to make sure that we're addressing these catastrophes as fast as we can. There's no replacement for that where you put someone on the ground in a truck and he can even get to the remote locations that conductors walk to every day from the head end of a train that's out there right where the accident occurs. So it's just one of many ways that this is a cost-cutting mechanism. It is fewer people doing more work, and it has nothing to do with the safe operation, in our opinion.
Thank you very much. Well, I have family that are involved in rail, and they've got a long history there. And hopefully you'll have greater success. I want to urge the rail operators to sit down and bargain in good faith with our brothers and sisters in the rail union.